24. Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to the service this morning. This is our largest number yet in terms of attendance, and we're glad that you were able to come today. And once again, we ask the blessing of God upon Tabernacle Baptist as we meet from Sunday to Sunday. We'll be having an evening service here tonight at 6:30, and again, we appreciate the people that are able to come out to that, and that provides several other people an opportunity to come that may not be able to come in the morning. So thank you for being faithful. This has been a testing time for our church, along with many others, and some are not faring as well as even we have been. But I do appreciate the fact that you've been faithful, faithful in helping, faithful in serving, faithful in giving. This morning we're going to begin with a song, Oh How I Love Jesus. It's number 92 in your hymn book. We'll use that to begin the morning program. God, our Father, it is our joy to be in your house, today. And we pray, Father, for those around the world who are meeting in your name today. And we pray, Father, for the blessing of God to fall upon us. We need today to trust Jesus Christ in a full way, more than ever we've accomplished in our life so far. So to trust, so to follow more closely in his way. We do pray, Father, for the churches of North America, Central America, South America, and Europe and around the world.
Today, so many under great strain and stress. Many places
where it's even hard
to worship in any method of freedom whatsoever.
So we
do pray, Father, as we go along our life's way, that we might trust you and realize that one of these days you will bring us relief.
And revival.
So it is with grateful hearts
we come into your
house to acknowledge Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. To that end, we ask your blessing upon all we say,
all we sing,
all we pray, and all we do here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So again, a warm welcome to everyone listening today. In various communities, and I was talking to my sister-in-law this morning, who's back in Maine at the present time, but lives in North Carolina for a number of months per year, and she was mentioning about one large church that gathered in the parking lot of a huge parking lot, and they set things up. It wasn't too long before the police came to break it up. That's the kind of society we live in, whether it's in the U.S. of A. or in Canada, and the rules seem to be slanted against churches in the sense of the word and make it even more difficult in Nova Scotia. So if we ever
follow their rules, you all have to have masks on.
So that seems to be the way that they are guiding their people down there this week, and in the same way with restaurants and stores. It's going to be tough eating, but we'll have to drop the mask periodically to get a bite. Less. So keep praying
that God's blessing will fall.
And there are good news items in terms of
people being blessed with refreshing knowledge,
scientifically
and medically, that makes things look a little better for the future, not only with vaccines, but even with those
kinds of drugs. One specialist the other day I was hearing who said that he's worked for so many years in procedures, and the biggest problem we have with this disease is inflammation once you happen to have it. And the drugs that they use for transplants are very applicable to this
problem. Also, some of the cancer drugs apparently now are the ones that they're actually using
when people are in dire straits in the hospital. So just be praying for those who have that kind of knowledge and know-how and are learning every day.
When the vaccines come sooner or later, there are people working on other types of things that are apparently very productive
with
those who are really sick. So keep praying
for our land, certainly the leadership of our land, and whether no matter
where it is,
need help, it doesn't matter
what country you're in these days. So having
said all of that,
again, God's
blessing upon you. Things over to Renee for a little while.
All right. Good morning, everybody. It's encouraging to see all of you. So that's I'm blessed myself to see you all here. And maybe turn to your hymn book there. I'll invite you to join me in just to follow along if you like. And if you feel comfortable to sing, then feel free to do that. So 109 is the first hymn, Lamb of Glory.
that kings and priests and prophets heard there would be a sacrifice and blood would flow to pay sin's price. Precious Lamb of glory, love's most wondrous story. Heart of God, redemption of man, worship the Lamb of glory. On the cross, God loved the world while all the powers of hell were hurled. No one there could understand. The one they saw was Christ the Lamb, precious Lamb of glory, love's most wondrous story. Heart of God, redemption of man, worship the Lamb of glory.
To 129. Great and mighty. We'll do this twice.
Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He. Lift up your banners, let the anthems ring. Praises to our King. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He. Lift up your banners, let the anthems ring. Praises to our King. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He.
And 184. Thy word.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid and I think I lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me too. My feet and a light unto side. I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Now, at this time, I'd like to take some of your favorites, either from the hymn book or the chorus book. In the chorus book. Yeah? Or in the hymn book? Chorus. All right. Things are different now. Peace like a river. We'll do one more after this one, okay? So, let's see.
Burdens all the way. Now it's my house heavy with a load of
Okay, 105. Everybody ought to know. So we'll finish this segment with this song, okay?
Thank you, Renee and Sandra, and thank you for sharing with some of those favorite pieces that we know so well. Now, this morning, it's our privilege to, first of all, receive the morning tithes and offerings. The plates are on the outside of the aisles there, so free to do your offering at this hour. Once again, let us give thanks for the offerings that have come. So let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the opportunity of being here today. Thank you for the offerings that people have brought to the house of the Lord. And we thank you, Father, for the privilege we have of being found faithful. As the Bible says in Jesus' words, be found faithful in the smaller things of life, that we might have opportunities to do more for the Lord in the larger matters of life as we serve. So once again, bless the offerings that have been received, and may the blessings of God continue to fall upon this local assembly and also the churches of which others who are listening are a part of, wherever you may be found today. So once again, thank you, Lord, for your blessing in our hearts and in our lives. Give us peace that passes understanding and comfort that will endure through these troubling moments of life. We pray in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Now, this morning, is there anything else I've missed? Yes, on the back, quite prominent there, on a turquoise envelope, there's Bev's current phone number as they moved him again. He's in room 13. So if you want to call him at any time, you can find the information provided on the back wall there, and it will give you an idea where he is and the room number where he may now be reached. So many months that he's been in there, and time has gone by so well. I guess it hasn't been quick for him. Maybe it hasn't been that quick for you or either, but nonetheless, the months have marched on. The last Sunday we recorded information in our treasurer's information book, I think, was back on March 15th. And so it's been since March 15th, March 22nd. I don't know whether we met a little bit that day at all, but anyway, from that point on, we've been doing what we can the way we are attempting to do it. And we are working bit by bit on getting our technology so that more people can listen in. And constantly, almost daily, there are people looking to join this Facebook page. I don't know where they all have come from and who may have suggested any of these names. And right now, there's around 130 names on the list. But when I can get it transferred to Sandra's Facebook account, which is different again, one particular morning program I did had around 140 just that one day. So there are people listening, and their opportunities are out there. If we keep expanding, at least there are people in various places that may not otherwise be listening to other messages or programming. So anything you want to do to encourage this or to help me and Renee to do our work as best we can, we'd always take any encouragement we can receive. Now, so the children are going to go with Sandra for this morning hour. And as they leave, I want to turn your attention to the Word of God. The point of the message today, if God is God, then serve Him. Is God, then serve. And I'm going to read from a passage of scripture in 1 Kings 18, verses 21 to 29, and then complete the reading by moving ahead to verses 36 to 39. So let me read these verses. It's a wonderful story. Many of you who know your word know the story quite. There's a lot of good in this story today. And this is the reading as follows. So 1 Kings 18, beginning to read at 21. Elijah went before the people and said, "How long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him." But the people said nothing. And moving on to 23, he said, "Get two bulls for us. Let Baal's prophets choose one for themselves and let them cut it into pieces and put it on the wood, but not set fire to it. I will prepare the other bull and put it on the wood, but not set fire to it. Then you call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord. The God who answers by fire, he is God." And all the people said, "What you say is good." Verse 26, "Then they, the prophets of Baal, called on the name of Baal from morning till noon. Baal answered us," they shouted, but there was no response. No one answered. They danced around the altar they had made. At noon, Elijah began to taunt them, "Shout louder. Perhaps he's deep in thought or busy or traveling. Maybe he is sleeping and must be awakened." So they shouted louder and slashed themselves with swords and spears, as was their custom, until their blood flowed. Midday passed, and they continued their frantic prophesying until the time for the evening sacrifice, but there was no response. No one answered, no one paid attention. Verse 36. Next, Elijah prepared his sacrifice. At the time of sacrifice, "Israel, let it be known today that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant, and have done all these things at your command. Answer me, Lord. Answer me so these people will know that you, Lord, are God, and that you are turning their hearts back again." In verse 38, it's recorded, "Then the fire of the Lord fell and burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, and the soil, and also licked up the water in the trench. When all the people saw this, They fell prostrate and cried, "The Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God." There are some other elements in that story that we'll mention as we go through, but I wanted to read that portion to begin. It was a day to be remembered, friends, when the multitudes of Israel were assembled at the foot of Carmel, and when the solitary prophet of the Lord came forth to defy the 450 priests of the false god. So that's the scenario. The odds were not good, 450-1. But today, that's what I want you to take out of this message, among any other things that may come out for your understanding. And we need to know that one man with the living God is greater than all of the false prophets of our generation, all the naysayers. We live in a troubled time, and people are not allowed to physically go to many churches in North America without opposition. And we're finding that there are people in our provinces and in our states across the border who, with the authority that they have, are using it not only perhaps for good, but even for other things that are not as pleasant. We need to be praying that things will get back in order so people will have the governments doing that which is proper and decent in all areas. And we're thankful for what we have here in this province at this point. But at the same time, there have been issues between people as they realize that people with authority certainly can use their authority. And we trust that it's for the best. But be careful and be watchful as you go along everyday life. Now, it was upon that hill of Carmel, and along the plain there were three kinds of people. First, the devoted servant of Jehovah, Elijah. Second, the decided servants of evil, that is, the 450 prophets of Baal. But you know, the vast majority of that day belonged to a third class, those who were wavering between two opinions. The King James is wide halt between two opinions or two choices. The word halt has the same background meaning as being lame. And you can picture a lame man not walking very steadily and not being on course. And so the word used in the translation I used today was wavering. Why halt? Why waver between two opinions is what it says. And you go on to read about it, it gives the picture of someone not being able to walk properly and is weaving back because of their condition that they are in. And so it is true today that we have that third class still that we're dealing with around the world this morning. Those who halt between two opinions. Those who waver. Those who sort of walk along, but in an unsteady fashion. They haven't made their choice. Today, here, hopefully because we have made our choice. We have declared for Jesus Christ. We have made a point of this. Now, there's several sections. First one is that the situation looked bleak. What about your situation in St. John? Situation looks bleak here, but it could become bleaker once you are forced to mask, if that should be the case, to do whatever you do. And so we have to be prepared. Other things down the road. So the situation looks bleak. Now remember, they came out of Egypt, as we know the story. They experienced transformation by the presence of God in the wilderness for a period of 40 years. Things went well for a period of time until you come to the time of the judges, as you read the book of the judges in the Word of God. And that was when another generation arose after them who did not know the Lord nor the work which he had done for Israel. Judges 2 and 10. What it was a national backsliding. This morning, I just read yesterday, and there's always statistics, so you have to see where they come from, but there was one that was saying probably I would say 40 years ago or so, that 70% of Americans attended church in their situation. By last year or the year before, the figure showed that only 18% were attending church. We are a backslidden people in North America. Our leaders are not practicing Christians. They're not living the life. We have corruption in our own government in Canada. We have lots of problems. No, you don't have to go across the border to see issues. We have them right around the corner. But what I'm saying this morning, the situation sometimes appears bleak in the nations of the world. There is a backsliding, as it were, where people are not following the Lord's way as they perhaps did in an earlier generation. And particularly among the 18 to 25-year-old bracket, it seems that COVID seems to be expanding more and more in various places. They hardly are in church at all. So, a difficult situation. It looks bleak. And then, of course, in the Bible stories, King Ahab and his wife Jezebel came along on the scene, and you know what they were like. They forced idolatry on Israel and murdered almost all the prophets of the Lord. You know, we never know when things will take a turn for the worse. Christians may not be able to be openly able to witness. And it's even that's now approaching. But I can say this, no country, no nation is beyond being reclaimed by God. God can reclaim. Think of Nineveh, the city. God spared Nineveh when Jonah finally got the word there, as you know, in spite of his disobedience. And God saved Saul of Tarsus, the man who set out to murder Christians and destroy the first church if he could have. But just a reminder that God can save a nation, God can save an individual, doesn't matter who. So we're looking at the problems in our land and the difficulties we're facing, but everything under coronavirus has got worse. And you know, forcibly closed in certain places in the U.S. and here in Canada. Yesterday there was a service, I don't know how they withstood it, but there was a service for a departed person here at the St. Joseph's Cemetery yesterday. And we were helping the family a wee bit with some of the issues surrounding and how they stood for an hour in that blazing sun yesterday and did their service completely there is beyond me. And but there were many, many dozens of cars that came out of Fundy and proceeded there. That was their meeting point. But I, you know, when I stop and look at the issues of what is happening to families, I just found out today that Sandra's sister's husband's mother died of COVID, and the brother was scared to go to the hospital because his mother died when they took her. And so people are panic-stricken, overwhelmed by fear. Now, I meet other people, and it doesn't bother them a bit. We live as we live. But other people will not budge an inch. And so have to try to understand where everybody's coming from at this point in time. It's very difficult. And I mean, even now, we've been able to get, some of you have been able to get to see Bev, for an example. Before, what was it, several weeks ago, that wasn't even allowed or contemplated. So for us, that's an added blessing right now that we can get in to see people. But remember, as we look at our situation, as we compare ourselves to the time of Israel when this was being talked about and written about, we also find ourselves probably in a time of crisis, maybe in that class of people. Perhaps we're not, but perhaps we are. We're wavering between two opinions, where we're not sure what we ought to do and what move we ought to make, what choices we need to follow. So that's the situation that looked bleak. The second part is Elijah's question. It really totaled three observations that he came up with. The question, of course, is how long will you waver between two opinions? So that's the key in the whole chapter. Now, there were people there in that day. I'm sure there are a lot of people like that in our country. They like to have a little bit of God, but they like to have a little backup. Now, in that case, it was Baal, polytheistic worship, and the worship of the one true God. Now, some people like to mix things. And it's the same way today. People like to have a little bit of the world mixed in with their so-called religion. So we have to be careful when we stop and look at the question that was being asked. How long will you waver? So these people didn't want to reject Baal out of hand, and they didn't want to reject the God of Israel out of hand, so they thought maybe they could cover all the bases, that both gods could be worshipped, and their hearts could be sort of divided between the two. Now, Elijah said no. He said, if God is the creator, the life giver, if God is eternal, immortal, present, and omnipotent, then God deserves our whole devotion. Not satisfied with half. Half for the Baal God, half for the true and living God. And of course, Elijah said it very plainly that he said, if Jehovah indeed is God, then a definite. Now we know God, it says, but God is God in the Word of God. Scriptures in the New Testament said you can't serve two masters. So we have to make that choice, don't we? I mentioned earlier, or halting between two opinions. He paints a picture of the absurdity of their present condition. So here they're over here, they're over there. Not quite where they ought to be, obviously. And in a play, how long will you limp between opinions? So he was using satire, trying to prod the people into a decision. Satan has a field day with us who are weak-minded. So if you're weak-minded, be careful in any way, because Satan, I'm sure, laughs at weak-minded people. We need to be strong in the Lord, not wavering, not being tossed about by the winds of the world, the seas of the globe we live. How long will you halt between two opinions? How long will you stagger back and forth? That was one that they should have been thinking about. Your Bible this morning, there was a drought in the land. For 3.5 years, this area of the world depends on rain to have a crop. And for 3.5 years, there was none. You would think that would have been a wake-up call, wouldn't you? How many wake-up calls do we have today in the affairs of the earth? 3.5 years of rain had passed, and they still hadn't decided to repent of worshiping the false god Baal. So on the other hand, the question is today, what is it going to take to get you and me to seek the Lord with all our hearts? Isn't it bad enough yet? A worldwide disease like one of the plagues of Revelation has struck us. As you well know, hordes of locusts are devouring many countries in Africa and Asia. Pretty well, every country is in some matter or form of economic collapse. We all know that there are riots in the cities. Political turmoil, racial hatred is being stoked everywhere, even here in Canada. I didn't laugh to myself. I cried maybe under my breath. If anybody here had their baseball game on at all this week. On the pitcher's mound, besides the national or the baseball league's insignia, there was BLM on the pitcher's mound. On the pitcher's mound, rather. And I'm getting to the point, you see, myself. Knowing this, that if you said Black Lives Matter in certain places here, even in this province, people would applaud. But if you ever opened your mouth and said All Lives Matter, you're certainly in the black book. But that's just one example, and one could dredge up many others. We're not out of the woods in our province by any stretch of the imagination, and all of these things are going to keep coming and coming and coming, and hopefully they will not become explosive as they are elsewhere. Many people have been wavering. Today is to make sure that you've made up your mind, that you're not going to go around limping, staggering from left to right, but that you will follow a straight course because you know the living God and you're going to follow the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, you know, this decision can be made in a moment. You don't have to wait till tomorrow comes to make up your mind as to what you're going to do. You know as well as I that today is the day of salvation. If I delay making the decision for God today, it's equivalent to rejecting God today. That's why this is so important. You know what I found when I was reading this? After all these things were said, excuse me, and everything was laid out, it said there was silence from the people. They said nothing. It's like now, total silence. That was the reaction of the people of Israel when he was asking them to make that decision. They didn't answer. The prophet asks, who's on the Lord's side? And nobody answers. It reminds me of a comic strip. Some of you may have seen this one. It's Hagar the Horrible. Listen to this. Hagar was pumping up the troops. This is the moment we've been waiting for, men. The moment we do battle with the enemy. Is everyone here? And they all shout, yes. Hagar continues, okay, men, repeat after me. I am a Viking warrior. They all shouted, I am a Viking warrior. And I will fight to the death for what I believe. And in the next frame of the cartoon, there's silence. In the third frame, he asks, okay, why aren't you repeating after me? One meek Viking speaks for them all. Hagar, the man would like to change that to, and I will fight hard until it's time for dinner. And you know, friends, there's a lot of truth to that. We'll follow you, but at 5, I got to go home. My wife's expecting me for lunch or whatever. But it just gives you the idea, you know, that if you're going to put your shoulder to the plow, as Jesus said, and if you want to plow a straight furrow, you've got to do this by committing your all to Jesus Christ. You see, many don't mind giving a little, but not our all. In the last third of this message follows on the others, and that is that Elijah confronts compromise. We live in a compromised world, a compromising generation. I was at some place yesterday, and somebody, there were some chocolate brownies there. And you know, when you see chocolate brownies today, what do some people think immediately? Marijuana brownies. And this person said, is there marijuana in those brownies? No, there is not marijuana in those brownies. But the person said, well, if you ate a few of those, some older lady said, I've eaten 3 of them. He said, well, you should be feeling the effects by now. But I don't know. But this is the world we live in. People that one time would have had a moral fiber now have none They've compromised with the world and just about anything and everything. And maybe there's some value to some of these things. Nobody's saying that there may not be, because most everything that God has made under the sun has some value when used properly. But at the same time, that's the kind of an attitude you see. Anyway, Elijah was an underdog. Maybe you're an underdog in your situation at times. Badly outnumbered, 450-1. We know just by our minds, calculations, that's pretty bad odds. But he had someone to back him up. God was in his corner. And you remember how in the scripture he heckled the prophets of Baal. And he even let them go first. You know, you go first. Set this ox on fire. And they started around 9 o'clock in the morning. They went till 3 in the afternoon. And no matter whether they shed their own blood or cut themselves or hit themselves, nothing happened. And you just hear them say, yell a little louder. God's out there, your God's out there having a nap or maybe on a trip. Call louder. And so the louder they called and the more blood that issued from cuts on their body, nothing happened. There was no answer, no voice, and no fire from heaven. As far as the people watching, it was a fool. Because even though I didn't read that section, it says he rebuilt the altar with 12 stones, one for each tribe of Israel. And then he dug a trench around it. This is the interesting part. He dug a trench around all of the area where he was setting things in place, put the wood there, cut up the oxen, asked them to bring, to top it off, 4 barrels of water and pour it on the offering and on the wood itself. And he did it 3 times. The water flowed around the altar and even filled that trench that was around the base of the sacrificial area. Of course, everybody was probably thinking, what is he doing? Nothing can ever happen in a situation like this. It'll never burn with all that water. But you know, this is interesting. You know, we are going to have hard things happen in life. And God doesn't mind if you make it hard for him to do something. Gideon asked for the fleece to be wet and then to be dry. God waited until it was just Jonathan, son of King Saul, and his servant to defeat the whole army of the Philistines. Just Jonathan and his servant. 2 swords. That's all there was. Now look at this. Think about this with me. His attitude toward God's fire. You think about this with me. Elijah anticipated the fire. Elijah expected the fire of God to fall. And not only that, he wanted the fire. And that's what I'm saying to you today. We need to want the fire of the Lord in this church and in our hearts and in our lives. And when you get that fire of God in you, it'll transform you. You'll start to think differently and start to walk differently. You become kingdom-oriented, oriented to the kingdom of God. Revival starts with each individual person sitting here today. No matter who you are, what your experiences in life have been, revival starts with you and me. In order to be consumed by the fire, you have to have that encounter with Jesus. So I'm asking you, when you come here, are you expecting something to happen? Are you expecting an encounter with Jesus Christ? Are you expecting him to meet you here in your pew, in your heart? Every time we go to church, every time we go to prayer, are you expecting him? Are you anticipating a blessing? Anticipating that God will come down and touch her? I want to close with one illustration today. I thought it was kind of an appropriate one. It's called The Confiscated Book. It was a young girl in Colombia. She had received the New Testament at school through the Gideon ministry, apparently. And she read it until her father caught her reading and told her not to read it again because it was full of lies and fantasy. But the girl kept on reading it. And one day her father came home unexpectedly and found her with the New Testament. He grabbed it from her hands and put it in his pocket. He went off to work the next morning, where he was a mining engineer. Several hours later, sirens went off in the community. There had been a cave-in at the mine. The father was trapped in the mine. The rescue workers took 5 days to finally reach the men, but it was too late. All 31 men had perished, including the father of the little girl. Curiously, the workers found the man clutching the New Testament between his praying hands. When they opened the front cover, read a note, "To my daughter, keep reading this New Testament. It is true and right, and I will see you one day in heaven." The back page where the father had signed the commitment card, as you see in most New Testaments the Gideons produce, after having said the sinner's prayer. But that wasn't the end of the story, turning the page. There were signed the names of the other 30 workers. Thank God for changes of heart. What God can't do, we wouldn't even mention. What God can do, all the cans that people come up with in their minds, God can do. So I'm just concluding today and asking you, have you ever maybe been wavering in your dedication to Christ? How many of you want God's fire to fall on your life today? And remember, Jesus is calling you into a relationship with God through him. How many will say yes? How many have said or will say the sinner's prayer, asking Jesus to be your Lord and Savior? So this message, I hope, is a blessing to you and me this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for those who are here and for the privilege we have of sharing our thoughts with others through the internet, through Facebook. If there's something worthwhile in anything I said today, Father, may it hit home to the heart of the sinner, to the heart of those who need to repent as well of sins, even sins that we've committed this week, Father. Help us to keep short accounts with God so that we know that we're up to date in the confession of sin and the cleansing of our hearts. Now, Father, bless us as we close with the singing of a song, that it might be truly a blessed day to have been in the house of the Lord together. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. I'm going to ask you to turn for one more hymn today, and it's number 434. I thought I'd ask to our list for this morning. It's revive us again. How we need that in North America and around the earth today. Revive us again. Number 434. Let's rise as we sing.
We praise.
prayer, Father in heaven. Once again, it is our privilege to be in fellowship with fellow saints. And we thank you, Father, that we are a privileged people. We're thankful for the life we have in our province of, and we're thankful for what you are doing in our hearts. That they might know your peace as well as we. And once again, go with us along the way of life. That the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ would be the greatest blessing of all today. In Jesus' name, amen.